Dr. Gordon Plant is a neuro-ophthalmologist who's published widely and extensively on just about anything and everything to do with the eyes and the brain. He was one of the first to study the curious phenomenon of visual snow, and he's going to tell to us about that now, Gordon.
Thank you, Arnold, and thank you very much for inviting me to talk here. This is, compared to migraine and that's just been discussed, this is a baby topic. And I'm going to just take you through the history of how we've come to where we are now with visual snow. Curiously, it goes back to a paper that didn't mention visual snow or anything like it. A psychiatrist who was who treated people with drug disorders related to recreational drug use, came across this this phenomenon which he described as a flashback. So these were patients who were having flashbacks to visual experiences that they had during the effects of LSD or and other drugs. He didn't actually mention visual snow, but he mentioned other things that are now part of that syndrome, such as positive and negative after images, trailing comet trails behind moving objects, and so on. But later on, here you can see in 1992, very well-known neuro-ophthalmologists in the US associating visual snow with this same disorder, hallucinogen persisting perception disorder, HPPD. However, there was a parallel literature going on where people thought this was due to migraine. And indeed, it was often referred to as persistent migraine aura. And you can see a few of the articles here which referred to it as such. Now, I'm highlighting here some ex-students of mine and showing how delightful it is when we remain in contact with them around the world. So in 2014, three articles appeared, and two of them were involved students of mine, Mathieu Aubert in France and Anne-Catherine Bessero in Switzerland. And Goadsby's group also published on in from California. And what we noted was that persistent after images were a feature of this, and indeed some patients present with persistent after images without visual snow. And others had also observed this connection, and so it became established as a syndrome. And this was, as you can see, less than 10 years ago. So why snow? Well, to younger people, this is a bit of a problem because this depended on the experience of an analog TV, which has no signal and is in fact receiving all of the radiation left over from the Big Bang. And what you get on the screen is a dynamic version of this. In fact, in Scandinavian countries, this was always referred to as the War of the Ants. Rather, they seem to see the black dots more prominently than the white dots. Nowadays, patients often come along referring to this as pixelation rather than, but visual snow is very much stuck as a descriptive term. And one possibility is that this is actually a form, a perception of noise in the visual system. And when I was in Cambridge, I had the pleasure to get to know Horace Barlow, who died a couple of years ago. And he was very interested in the eigengrau, which was the idea that there was that we could actually perceive noise in the visual system in darkness. And it was related to the fact that the eigengrau, that what we see in complete darkness is not like black, it's gray. And but I think what most of us see at low light levels is very similar to visual snow. Certainly, I find that if I get up in the middle of the night, go to the bathroom, it does look like visual snow. This is a representation from one of Puletta's papers. You'll be hearing much more about her shortly as an illustration. So what else do we see with visual snow? Persistent after images. This has been called palynoptria. It's not quite the same thing because these are very much retinotopically located, whereas palynopsia refers to images which can reappear anywhere in the visual field. But they can be positive or negative. So they're not like classical after images showing, for example, being the complementary color or reverse contrast. Trailing of images may be related to this. Now, I found a lot of patients complained of jumping of text when reading and had difficulty reading. This hasn't come out in other studies. Starbursts around lights, seeing light through the closed lids, in the dark, amorphous dynamic colors. Floaters, now these are only seen when there's light entering the eye. They're effectively like shadows on the retina. And one example of that is the blue field endoptic phenomenon, where it's actually the white blood cells that are acting as the floaters. But many of these are normal, indeed universal endoptic phenomena, but which individuals may not be aware of throughout their lifetime. So here's the blue field endoptic phenomenon. These are white blood cells going through the capillaries in the retina, which you can see when you look up at a clear blue sky. And I've met many patients, many individuals, shall we say, not patients, but individuals who've never, ever been aware of these. And you take them out, if there happens to be a blue sky, and they see them for the first time. They've been there their entire life. This was a wonderful example of using this phenomenon to monitor the treatment of leukemia. So they were using the density of the blue field phenomenon to determine the improvement in the blood level of the leukemic cells. And many patients with visual snow report that their vision has been like this all their lives, and they didn't know it was abnormal until they read about it. Some of the non-visual features are also quite common in the general population, particularly tinnitus and tremor. And I have also seen patients who remit and relapse. It's unusual, but I have seen that happen. Now, Dennis Pelly looked at this in terms of the possibility that visual noise is underlying this. And he found that you can measure the amount of noise in the system by adding noise. And he found that adding more noise, patients behaved exactly like normals. There doesn't seem to be an increased amount of noise. Now, I don't think this is, I can't find that this was ever published. But more recently, Owen White in Australia has looked at this again and has found exactly the same thing, if you, by estimating internal noise, looking at contrast gain, they found that there is no evidence for increased internal noise in patients with visual snow, but there is evidence of contrast gain. And we're getting here rather into the context that we've seen with other causes of visual discomfort. Now, as I say, many of the patients that I have seen did complain of problems with reading. So we would use these colored overlays, ask the patients to take these away, try them at home, try them in the clinic and so on. Often they would find this helpful with reading, and some would go on to have tinted lenses. Now, another ex-student, Claire Fraser, she has looked at patients in Australia, and she had a dozen patients who went through a dyslexia protocol of intuitive colorimetry, and 11 out of the 12 found that their symptoms improved, and the blue-yellow was chosen in 10 out of those 11. And she wondered why this may, whether this may involve increased corneolith cellular activation and somehow being alleviating cortical hyperexcitability. No one has looked at that directly, but here's another student of mine, Ghislaine Traber, who's now in Switzerland. And their group has looked at structural changes in visual snow. And they found that the lingual gyrus was actually the gray matter volume of the lingual gyrus on the right in their patients was in fact increased. And that this increase positively correlated with the length of the period that the patients had had symptoms. Others, Traber's group also showed increased connectivity in the occipital lobe and its connections with the temporal lobes and other visual areas. And this was also found by Puleda, who's in Peter Goadsby's group at King's now in the UK. And they also found evidence for increased connectivity differences comparing visual snow with healthy controls. And Puleda has also published a very useful review of treatment response. What they have done is they have through a website, they have literally thousands of patients who have this syndrome that they can contact. And writing papers on it with a thousand patients, and here 400 patients is now very common through this kind of setup. And they were able to show that really response to medical treatment, pharmaceutical treatment, is virtually zero in this disorder, which was certainly my experience, not from trying it myself, but from patients who've been treated with treatments that might be effective in migraine and so on in the past. So that's where we are with visual snow. We now have a great deal more information on the possible underlying substrate of this, all in the last few years. And now we're looking for better ways to manage the disorder. Thank you again for listening, and thank you, Arnold.
Thanks very much, Gordon. That was fascinating.
This is a question, I guess, for the wider panel, and perhaps touches, Arnold, on your particular presentation. But have precision tints helped to reduce or affect visual aura in any way?
Don't know. They should do. Maybe Karen, you've seen a lot of migraine patients. Is that something they tend to report?
How I look at visual aura, I'm not a migraine specialist, but visual aura, that is the onset of the perceptual distortions that they experience as their brain is hyperactivating. And the precision tinted lenses reduce the perceptual distortions. So if the illusions of light and color and movement and whatever aura is described as for that individual are reduced with the precision tints, then my answer would be yes, it will reduce the visual aura, because it will also reduce the onset of the migraine as well.
Could I ask Gordon Plant whether he thinks this is a possible explanation for visual snow?
What, migraine?
No, is it an extension of the aura? Is it a continuous aura?
I don't think so. I think there's a very close relationship between migraine and visual snow. But I think the link is the hyperexcitability underlying both disorders. There isn't time to go through every single variety of migraine aura that I've ever heard described. I've only experienced one myself at the age of 50, but I've heard many, many descriptions. And in fact, this would be extremely unusual as a description of a visual aura. And of course, we think that the aura itself is a form of it's not an epileptic disturbance, but it's something very, very close to it, spreading depression, And it's an electrical disturbance in the brain which moves more slowly through the cortex than the epileptic disturbance. But I think it's where there'll be a link is really that there's very likely to be an overlap between migraine and visual snow, as indeed most of the studies have shown.
So it was consistent with a contrast gain going too high, something like that?
Yes, I mean, certainly that's Owen White and Badcock have looked at that. And that seems to be the result that gives us the best explanation at the moment. Rather than there being an increased level of noise in the system, it's the perceptual awareness of it. That's what distinguishes it. And of course, many of the other things that they describe, as I say, are normal entoptic phenomena that many people go through their lives without ever experiencing as a perception, but they're there. I mean, floaters is a very good example. And so often patients come to the clinic and they say, I've got all these things like spider webs in my eye that they came last Thursday, I've never seen them before. And you say, no, these have been there for a long time. The brain does a very good job of abolishing from perception information that's not useful. And all the phenomena like change blindness and so on, all of these things fit with that idea. So I think a lot of the background phenomena that could reach perception do not do so in most people. But if you are in this, have this different wiring that migraineurs have and people with visual snow have, that's when they become aware of these things.
Yes, there's a recent paper by Huang showing just how different that wiring is using his FOPA methods.